Father, we do come tonight, and we do thank you, and we do give you all glory and praise in this place tonight. And we do ask you tonight, Father, you've heard all these names, Father, that have been lifted up. There are so many people on our hearts and our minds tonight, and we just lift them each and every one up to you, Father. You know that every single one of them has a very special need, and there's a very special concern that weighs on our heart, and we just ask you to touch and be with each one of these. We know there's a lot of physical problems and a lot of physical needs out there. We know, Father, there's also spiritual and emotional needs. We ask for your touch to be on that. We lift each and every one of them up to you tonight. We release them to you tonight, Father. We know that it's all in your power, in your control, and in your hands. We give each and every one of them, each and every situation over to you. Father, we ask your blessing on this service, on our singing, on the message later. Help us, Father, to be a light and a witness to one another. Help us to be an encouragement to one another. Help us to learn, not just about you, but to learn who you really are and what you really mean to each one of us. Guide our steps and direct our paths. We thank you tonight in Jesus' name. Amen.
I can face tomorrow Let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us come before Him with thanksgiving. For the Lord is the great God. In His hand are the depths of the earth. The sea is His. For He made it.
And His hands formed the dry land.
Come, let us bow down and worship.
Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker.
For He is our God.
And we are the people of His pasture.
Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord.
Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation.
Amen.
I will enter His gate with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter this court with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for He has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for He has made me glad. He has made me glad, yes He has made me glad. I will rejoice for He has made me glad. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord hath made. and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praise him as Savior. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of raptures now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior and happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
I'm so glad many years ago I had a mom and dad that loved me enough to take me to church and tell me that wonderful story of Jesus, of how he died on the cross that we can have life eternally. We read in Romans that no matter where we go or what we do, we need to be telling that wonderful story of Jesus and giving him praise.
Amen. What are you going to do first?
Let's do a slow one because I'll be out of breath.
Okay.
It's C.
Okay.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you got peace of mind like you've never known. But then things change and you're down in the valley. Oh, don't lose faith, my child, you are never alone, for the God on the mountain, oh, he's still God in the valley. When
Give God praise tonight. You know, we ask prayer requests and we pray for God to do something for us. And then when your life gets a little better, you forget to stop and thank God for what all he did do for
That's
you.
True,
it
man.
Might not turn out the way you prayed it would, but he's the master. He's got the masterpiece.
Yes,
we just
amen.
Have to trust him that he's going to get us through whatever comes our way.
Amen.
In my robe of white, I will fly away to that land so fair. Meet my Jesus there, it will be so grand when I get to that land. In my robe of white, I will fly away. First I'll hear that trumpet sound, then all saints be heaven bound. We'll cross over Jordan and wide, stop and do the other side. There we'll see those holy hills and my mansion he has built. Gonna be the first one in line, gonna see my name in the book of life. In my robe of white, I will fly away to that land so fair. Meet my Jesus there, it will be so grand when I get to that land. In my robe of white, I will fly away. Gonna be a wonderful time when I get to the other side. See my loved ones gone before, we'll be part from them no more. We'll be walking on streets of gold, surrounded riches and gold. When I look on Jesus' face, I know I'm saved by his amazing grace. In my robe of white, I will fly away to that land so far. See my Jesus there. Will be so grand when I get to that land. In my robe of white, I will fly away.
You know, it reminds me of the time when I first got saved. And I, you know, for quite a while, I couldn't understand why God chose me, you know. And I started going out visiting stuff after I got saved. I'd get up and testify, and I couldn't understand it. You know, I said, why, God, you know, why did you do me like that, you know? Before, I was ashamed to get up and do anything. And so, you know, I think a lot of times we question God, and he has plans for us.
He does.
And if we just hold on, he'll show us what he's got in store for us. And I'm so glad that, you know, back when I got saved, you know, we'd get up, after we'd get saved, we'd get up and testify what the Lord had done for us, for in our lives and stuff. And you don't see much of that anymore.
Amen, you don't.
Why me, Lord? What have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known? Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do that was worth loving you for the kindness you've shown? Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it so. Help me, Jesus, I know. Souls in your hands. Try me, Lord. If you think there's a way I could ever repay all I've taken from you.
Yes, Jesus.
Maybe, Lord, I can show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to you. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it so. Help me, Jesus, I know what I. Now that I know that I've needed you so, help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands. Lord, me, Jesus, I've wasted it so, help me, Jesus, I know. Now that I know that I've needed you so, help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands. Jesus, my soul's in your hands.
Talk of Jesus, how he was born in Bethlehem. Can we remind ourselves of Calvary and how he died for fellow man? Seldom do we speak of when he'll return and take us out. won't be at all like the last time, 'cause he'll descend with a shout. The next time he comes, he won't lay in a manger.
Turn your Bibles to the book of Romans, chapter 1. Patsy's already told us about the book of Romans. That's a good thing. I guess that means we're in the right spot. But tonight we're going to start doing something. You all remember when we went through the entire book of Matthew? I don't know how long it took. It took us a few days to get through it. But tonight what I thought we would do, actually I didn't think, this was kind of what the Lord led me to do, is we're going to start studying the book of Romans on Sunday nights, and we're going to go all the way through the book of Romans. And part of the reason that we're going to be focusing in on the book of Romans now is because for the past several weeks and however many more weeks on Sunday mornings, we've been talking about the church, being the church, and sharing the gospel, and doing all these things associated with the church, and we're trying to build up and get those skills. You know, this morning we talked about spiritual maturity, and we're trying to build those skills that it's going to require to do these things. And the book of Romans is a really good place for us to learn about God and about Jesus and about what we are like when God is not involved in our lives, and what we're like when Jesus is not our Lord, not our Savior, what our natural state is, I guess is the best way to put it. And it's also a good place to learn where God took us actually from. And it also tells us, you know, what's the expectation of us if we're not a child of God, as opposed to who we actually are when we are a child of God. So there's a whole lot. I mean, this book is jam-packed, and it's really a letter. It's an epistle is what it is, which is a formal letter is what that means. But we call it the book of Romans. And And the way Paul writes things, it seems like a book because he packs everything in here. And tonight we're going to cover chapter 1. And we're primarily going to spend most of our time, I guess, focused on that second half. But there's a lot in the very first half of that chapter that Paul gets into. And he's kind of laying the groundwork and the foundation for what's to follow. You know, Paul never just kind of jumps into things, and he always wants to introduce himself, and he always wants to introduce his authority, introduce why he's writing what he writes and why he's doing what he's doing. And that's really all he does there in the first part of it. I'm going to just read it here, and then we'll talk just a little bit about it. But it says here, starting in verse 1, it says, Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his son, who to his human nature was a descendant of David, and who through the Spirit of holiness, notice Spirit's capitalized, he's talking about the Holy Spirit, who the Spirit of holiness was declared with power to be the Son of God by his resurrection from the dead. Amen? Did we hear it? Let me read that again. Who through the Spirit of holiness was declared with the power to be the Son of God by his resurrection. In other words, witnessed by his resurrection from the dead. He is Jesus Christ our Lord. It says, through him and for his name's sake, we receive grace and apostleship to call people from among all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith. And you also are among those who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. Y'all realize that? You are among those who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. Every person within the sound of my voice is called to Jesus Christ. All of us. We all are called to God. It says, and you are among those who are called to belong to Jesus Christ, to all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints. You ever been called a saint before? I've been called a lot of things, but I don't think a saint's ever been one of them. It says, to all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints. He says, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. And we can stop right there. That's good, ain't it? That's good stuff, ain't it? And he's telling them this. He's not just trying to butter them up with this here. What he's trying to tell them, he's trying to establish a baseline for, number one, his authority to share this message with them. And the reason they should listen to what he has to say. He says, I'm Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus. He says, I've been called to be an apostle. He says, I've been set apart for the gospel of God. That's his authority to do this. And he says, what gospel is this? He says, it's the same gospel that he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. And it's what he's talking about is the Old Testament that prophesied for year after year and century after century about this coming Messiah. He's saying Jesus Christ is this coming Messiah. And he says, I've been given the authority and the ability to share the gospel, to share his message, to share the hope that's found in him with everybody, is what he's saying. You know, he says, and he's talking to the church there in Rome, and it's made up primarily of Gentiles. Gentiles who the converted Jews who had said, you're not worthy, you're not good enough. He's our Messiah. He's not your Messiah. And Paul says, no. He says, to all. Let me read the rest of it there. He says, first, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you. That's nice of him. He says, because your faith is being reported all over the world, so they've been doing something right. He says, God whom I serve, with whom my heart is in preaching the gospel of his Son, and my witness how constantly I remember you. In my prayers at all times. He says, I pray now that by at last God's will, the way may be opened for me to come to you. He wants to come visit them. He says, I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to make you strong. You know what his spiritual gift he was going to impart to them is? The knowledge and the understanding of God. The knowledge and the understanding of Jesus Christ. The knowledge and the understanding of the Holy Spirit and how the Holy Spirit works in our lives. He says, I want to come and share that with you. And he couldn't come physically. Well, he made it to Rome finally. But he was sharing through this word, through this book. You know, and it's the same. You know, the same reasons why these people that he was writing to needed to listen to what he says is the same reason that we need to listen to what he says. We need to understand what this letter says and what all of his letters say. We need to study them. You remember we talked about training ourselves. We need to be trained up in the Word of God and understand what it really says. Not what the preacher says it says. Not what the public says it says. Not what some other book somewhere out there says it says. What does the Word of God say to you? When you pick up God's Word and you read God's Word, what does it say to you? What does it speak to you? How do you understand it? How do you interpret it? All these other things are good, helps. But you have to get it. It has to apply to you. It has to get down into your soul. Or it's just words on a page. And he says, I long to see you that I may impart some spiritual gift to make you strong. That is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. You want why you need to come to church? There it is. He says that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. You know, we draw strength and faith from one another. We see what each other goes through. We see what each other endures. We encourage one another. Believe it or not, you all are an encouragement to me. Y'all know that? I like seeing y'all. I do. I really do. I would love to see all of you all the time. In church. I can't feed y'all. But I like to see all of you. I like to see this place full. That's an encouragement. And it's a discouragement when it's empty. Y'all think y'all the only ones that get discouraged when you walk in and there's more empty chairs than our people? Yeah, it's a discouragement. Y'all want to know the real reason? One of the very first things I did when I started pastoring here was take down our attendance thing that sat back there for years where that nice pretty picture's hanging out. Y'all want to know the real reason I took that thing off the wall? I didn't want to see it, and I didn't want anybody else to see it either. I stuck it back there in the corner. Because here's what it did. When I could see it. When I come in, and people, and we come back on like a Sunday night or the next week, and you know, last week's numbers were all up there. I'd come in, and if everybody come out and not everything the week before, everybody's in, that was all happy and things. And they come in though, and it wasn't a great week the week before, and they look at that thing, so, why'd they even bother? See, we put too much stock in those kinds of things. That's not what it's all about. None of that stuff is. You know, we got to report that stuff and do all that stuff. That's not what it's all about. And we should, and like I said this morning, other people's faith and other people's relationship with God should not have an impact on our relationship with God. That's our relationship with God, and unless it's a positive impact, I will say that, if somebody's helping and encouraging. But when somebody's tearing down and doing all these things and trying to drag you down with them, and don't fall for it. It's a trap. Yeah. Try to pull them up, and don't get down there with them. Because your relationship, the health of your relationship with God is not based on the health of somebody else's relationship with God unless you let it be. Does that make sense? How healthy your relationship with God is is related to how well you are in commune with God, in communication, and how well you are in tune with the Holy Spirit. Not somebody else down the road somewhere. Misery loves company, and it'll drag you down with it. Anyway, that's not even in my notes here. That's all. I'm completely off subject. Whew. So I don't think that's what Paul was talking about. Let me get back on subject. He says, I long to see you so that I may impart you some spiritual gift to make you strong. That is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. He says, I do not want you to be unaware. I believe it's in King James, Brother Bowen. Does it say ignorant? That's what I thought. It says, I don't want you to be ignorant. Now, ignorant ain't a bad word. It just means, like it says, unaware, uninformed, uneducated. Not knowing. You know, we turn that into a bad word. We tell people, you're just ignorant. Well, in reality, you think you're insulting them, but you're really not. You're just saying you're not educated on that. Yeah, a lot of people say stupid now. My kids, everything to my kids were stupid. That's just stupid. You don't ever say that, do you, Devin? He smiled. He's not even going to answer because he don't want to lie in church. He says, I do not want you to be unaware, brothers, that I planned many times to come to you, which he did. He says, but have been prevented from doing so until now, in order that I might have a harvest among you, just as I had among the Gentiles. And, you know, he's laying it on to them there, talking about the Gentiles, saying, hey, guess what? This message is not just for you Jews. This message is for the Gentiles. And you need to get over yourself thinking that God has raised you above everybody else, because when Jesus came, he opened the door for everybody. You know, the Jews rejected him in those days, and so he opened it up for everybody. And we've all been adopted into God's family. And Paul says, I'm the apostle to the Jews and the Greeks and the Gentiles. And he says, well, here it is, I'm obligated to both Greeks and non-Greeks, both to the wise and the foolish. That is why I am so eager to preach the gospel also to you who are here in Rome. I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. You notice he says, I'm not ashamed. And it's a dig on them, because they were in that fear, that shame. Oh, we can't tell anybody we're a Christian. We can't let it get out. And the reason he calls them out on that is because that shame or that fear and that guilt and all that they're feeling, it's a lack of faith. They're afraid to step out in faith and to stand boldly for the Word of God. They're afraid to step out and say, yes, I follow Jesus Christ. Because it's a lack of faith. They're babes in Christ. They need to get off the milk. They need to get them a steak. Don't they, Tommy? Yeah, he raised up and I said, steak. Don't feel bad. I do too. Is it something at stake? But we need to get off the milk, on to the meat. He says, for in the gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it has been written, the righteous will live by faith. Now, all that before we ever get into the sermon. That's the first part of the chapter. Now the second part, see, he's kind of been priming them, getting them set up, because now he's going to go real deep. He's going to start getting some real deep things with them, some things that he's going to open their eyes to some things, open their eyes to the ways of the world, really, the way that the world thinks, the way that the world acts, the way that things go in just the world in general. He says the wrath of God, this is verse 18, is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. He says, since what may be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal powers and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what he has been made, so that men are without excuse. See, we like to make excuses. We like to make excuses for everything. Most of the time, we like to make excuses why we're not at fault for anything. Well, that's somebody else's fault. Now, it's not my fault that I run into the back end of your car. It's your fault. The car shouldn't have been there sitting in that parking spot. It don't have nothing to do with the fact that I was doing this. Now, that's my problem. I have a tendency when I'm driving to go the direction I'm looking. That can get dangerous. When I see something over here, so I'm like, what is that? But I know it's time to slow down or stop, because I see Michelle do this, grabbing on to something. Or she'll go, oh. But it says, but we like to make excuses. That's where I was going with that. But it says, we are without excuse. For although they knew God, neither glorified God and him as God, nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile. Their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools. And exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images to look like mortal man and birds and animals and reptiles. It says, therefore God gave them over to the sinful desires of the heart, to sexual impurity, for the degrading of their bodies with one another. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator, who is forever praised. Amen. Now, that's a lot there, but the first point there is the fact that he's talking about God's wrath, and he's revealing God's wrath. And here's the thing, if you are a child of God, a true child of God, you have nothing to worry about with God's wrath, because it does not apply to you. That's what Jesus saved us from, with God's wrath. And you see, everybody in this world fears God's wrath. Whether they're going to admit it or not, they are afraid of God's wrath, because they know that God's wrath is real. Whether they want to admit it, they know it. In their soul, they know it. And he says it's being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. And that's why it's being revealed. It's because of wickedness and evil and sin. And what makes it even worse, the truth of God is suppressed by people, denied by people. Oh, there is no God, or oh, this and all that. That's wickedness and evil and sin. Because they not only are denying it for themselves, they're convincing and deceiving others into believing their lies. But he goes on, he says, you know, even though, he says, what may be known about God is plain to them. Because God made it plain to all of us. You do realize God has made his presence known and plain to this earth since creation began? And you know, and we get into all this, well, we've got all this science that tells us there is no God. Baloney. Every bit of science out there points to God, points towards God. You know, all of our technological advances and all the things that we know and understand and all the things that we've learned, you know, there's one thing we can't do. We can't create life. Now, we can take what God's already created and copy it, reproduce it. But we can't create life. For all of our vast understanding of this universe, we can't even create one planet. Not one. God created an entire universe. People say, oh, it just happened. Well, that's the craziest thing I've ever heard. It just happened down to the minutest detail in true perfection. But, oh, it just happened. No, it did not. You know, and they say that, oh, you're just uninformed and uneducated, unaware. To me, that sounds crazy. Just like, oh, well, yep, just happened. How? Where did it come from? How did it get here? How did it start? You know, and you can believe in the purest, most out there form of evolution as you want to, but there has to be a starting point. It has to start somewhere. And it didn't just start out of nothing. Even if you believe that the latest is that space rocks. It was like a meteorite that hit Mars and blew off some space dust out into space and had small one-cell organisms on it. And they floated across the universe and landed on the Earth and kind of filtered down and got out in the ocean. And then they decided, well, we're going to get up out of this ocean. And they got up out of the ocean. They grew tails and legs and arms and everything else. And then they're all of us. Even if you believe that, where did it start? Where did it start? How did it get here? How is it so perfect? It has to be from God. And that's what he's saying. God has made his presence known to all of us. The thing that we seek out most in this universe is what? God. We seek out God because it's part of our innate creation, our innate nature, to seek out the one that created us. All of us, we do that. We know in our soul who God is. We don't acknowledge it sometimes, because when we acknowledge it, guess what? We have to take responsibility for it. And that's where we don't want to take responsibility. He says, since what being made known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made. So men are without excuse. Period. British say full stop. Period. we are without excuse. And we can try to make all the excuses we want, but we ain't got none. And the results of our denial of God is what we see in our world today. It's what Paul saw and what we see. It says in verse 21, "For although they knew God, they neither glorified Him as God nor gave thanks to Him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened." And this futile thinking, I think of it as thinking in circles or spirals even. It's not going anywhere. It's just going around and around and around and around. And we do that, we just spiral further and further and further and further away from God. And the further we get from God, the darker things become. The darker our hearts become. The darker everything becomes. And sooner or later, we spiral completely out of control. He says, this is what it's like. This is what they've done. He says, they claim to be wise, but they became fools. Says that they exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal man and birds and animals and reptiles. You know why they did that? Because that innate nature to seek out God. See, they spiraled so far out here and so far over here. And they're so far separated from God. They don't know how to get back. They don't know how they got to where they're at. And they don't know how to get back to where they need to be. So instead of trying, let's just make up some new ones. Let's just make up our own. And they built statues to cows and snakes and all these other weird-looking things, all these Greek gods and the Roman gods. I mean, some of these things look weird, too. See, we've not strayed too far from that either. And we may not build up big statues like we used to and fall down and worship them. We've got idols just the same. Other people, our jobs, our money, our stuff, our cars, our computers, all these things that we use to replace God. All an idol is something you use to replace God. You know what the biggest idol is? Ourselves. Yep, ourselves. And see, the draw to worship self is so strong, it will lead us to do anything and everything to feed into the desires of the flesh. Whatever it is. This is how they got to where they're at. It says, furthermore, this is verse 28. Since they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, He gave them over to a depraved mind to do what ought to be done. They have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, depravity. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, malice. They are gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. They disobey their parents. They are senseless, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Although they know God's righteous decree, and those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them. You want to know why things got the way they got? This is why. This is why. You know why? Really? God just gave them over to themselves. God has basically said to this world, you made your bed, now lay in it. You want to do it your way, have at it. And look around us. We see what decades and centuries of doing it our ways got us. It's our world that we live in. It's all because God just gave us over to ourselves. God didn't abandon us. God just respected what we asked for. Just gave us what we asked for. And that leads us to do whatever we want to do. And when we're left to our own devices, this is what we get. He says, therefore, this is backing up. God gave them over to their sinful desires of the hearts, to sexual impurity, for the degrading of their bodies with one another. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator, who for is forever praised. Amen. And because of this, God gave them over to shameful lusts. Even their women exchanged natural relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, the men also abandoned natural relations with woman and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed indecent acts with other men, received themselves in due penalty for their perversion. Furthermore, since they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, He gave them over to a depraved mind to do what ought to be done. See, we've just been given over to ourselves. But see, as Christians, we've been armed with this knowledge and this understanding. And we have an obligation to share what we know and what we understand with other people. To share the hope in Jesus Christ with other people. And we don't want to be responsible, but we are. We look around, we complain all the time. I hear people complain every single day about how awful this world is. Well, then do something about it. If it's so awful, don't just talk about it. Do something about it. Do your part to change it. You know how you change it? You share Jesus with people. Because we're powerless. God's all powerful. He can do anything. And one of the things I've learned from my own family that's living in sin, there's absolutely zero I can do to change them. Absolutely zero. It is up to them. 100% up to them. But we have the power to share the truth with them, to love them, and say, you know what? I love you, but I don't agree with what you're doing. And we get confused. We'll go one of two ways. We'll take it too far one way and just out and out be ugly towards them. Or we'll take it the other way and just kind of say, well, I just won't say nothing. Well, you got to find the happy medium. Let them know that you're there to help them, that you love them, and you support them. But sin is sin. And you can't support sin. And that's, you know, that's a hard balance, especially when you're dealing with people that you care about, people that you love, with your own family. It's a hard balance. See, that's where the Holy Spirit comes in, to give us the ability to respond to things and to do things in a godly way. Now, will we do it perfect every time? Nope. Nope. We won't. None of us will. None of us will. But when God tells us and shows us some of the things that we've done, it's not been so great or so perfect. Are we going back and trying to fix it? You know, just telling somebody that, oh, I'm sorry. That goes a long way. Y'all know that? When you mean it, when you say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. What we do, I'm sorry, but. Well, I want to hear you, but. They don't. All they want is, you know, I'm sorry. There's always time for that butt to come in later. It really is. But we've got to start living our lives in such a way that we reflect Jesus Christ every day. Because sometimes when your life reflects Jesus Christ every single day, a lot of times you don't have to say a whole lot. You don't. Because they know. People know. Especially people who have heard of Jesus and know about Jesus, they know. Honestly, they know. All you got to do is live Jesus in front of them. And that's enough. A lot of times that's enough conviction. That's more conviction than they can handle a lot of times. But also, don't ever quit praying for them. Don't give up on them. Just keep praying. Keep praying. Sooner or later, God's faithful. Keep praying. That's where we're going to end tonight. We covered the chapter. We did good. Don't know if we covered it the way y'all wanted to, but we covered it. So let's just have a word of prayer and dismiss tonight. If you need to come down to the altar and pray, come on down. But I think we're at a good stopping point. Father, we do come tonight. And I do thank you and praise you this evening. I ask you, Father, to be with all of us and just help us, Father. I ask for you to go before us and prepare a path. Help us, Father, to live our lives as a reflection of you to our families and our friends and all those we come into contact with. Help us to be the living gospel, Father. Guide us and direct us as we have interactions each and every day. Open us up and keep us safe. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.